how close are you to real life to what your records are?
This is real as this gun. Look, see this chamber right there? This is no bullshit. This is real. This is real gun.
9 millimeters in your ass.
9 millimeters.
That Hollywood bullshit, man.
You gotta carry these or you get fucked up on the street. So you gotta be prepared.
And this got an infrared scope on it. You put the dot on your target, then you blow the shit out the motherfucker.
From the beginning, hip-hop, and especially so-called gangster rap, has been saddled by this idea that it reflects reality. And of course, that's never really been true, but it definitely reflects the imagination of the people who make it, and certainly growing up in a violent or in a poor area is gonna affect your imagination.
The appeal of gangster rap is something to deal with the raw animal connection to violence and aggression that goes in the human psyche.
When I first heard Straight Outta Compton, yo, I really thought that Ice Cube was gonna fuck me up.
LA is where the focus of the cultural energy is.
When that Rodney King beating was caught on tape, I thought the same way that everybody else did. This is fucked up.
Snoop's delivery was just amazing.
I'm just on the microphone and I ain't perpetrating.
Hey, Tupac was just revolutionary.
I don't know how to change the world, but I know if I keep talking about how dirty it is out here, somebody gonna clean it up.
For the first 10 years of Rap on Record, not only did New York dominate rap, but there was almost nobody else involved.
New York City, at the end of the 80s, is really an exploding place. There's a lot of racially charged incidents. And the city is a cauldron of also creativity. There's all of these young black artists listening to the Malcolm X tapes with their, kente blankets. There's African medallions. There's a lot of racial consciousness.
Well, Public Enemy, we come from the 60s, and the politics of the 60s was, you know, stand up for yourself, know yourself, be black, you're proud, and, you know, you demand that you be equal. We got to fight the powers that be.
Public Enemy, they were beyond rappers. They were activists. They were revolutionaries. They made the whole community get together and sing those records when they heard it because it was just so incredible.
They were able to embody an era through their sound, the chaotic, confrontational aspect of the era. They spread both the mythology of Malcolm X and they helped advocate people pay more attention to Louis Farrakhan. Black people are looking for an alternative to the crack culture, which is everywhere.
Like comatose walking around, please don't confuse this with the sound. I'm talking about
crack, crack, everywhere you go, crack. You don't hear no dope, Harley. You don't hear no coke anymore, Harley. The only thing you hear is people saying jumbos, crack.
So if anybody offers you drugs, just say no.
If you just say no, you'll be saying yes to a whole lot more.
As the crack epidemic takes over the national black community, there's a different mood in hip-hop.
Crack fiends had to get high every 5 minutes. It wasn't like heroin where you fell asleep. You were high and you want to get high again. You want to get high again with McDonald's. It made crack fiends rob their mother, their brother, their sister. Women abandoned their children for this drug. And the money it turned over was so fast. All that money means more competition for the spots.
People are armed, people are dangerous, and people are acting irrationally. And that's something that you always have to be aware of 24 hours a day.
The level of firepower increases. The trafficking in weaponry also increases. So you have this escalation, 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 escalation.
This changes completely the nature of the music. The rappers start to reflect the crack trade, the violence surrounding the crack trade, and the materialism surrounding the crack trade. So what had been a culture designed to minimize violence in the ghetto and urban centers in the black community, put your knives down, put your gang wars down, we're gonna rhyme against one another, and we're gonna b-boy and break against one another, now becomes a culture that reflects a level of violence unforeseen in the black community.
What New York was in the late 80s, all this turmoil and this racial confrontation, we had musical and cultural explosion. LA becomes that for a while. A place that was percolating with a cultural war on the ground that is getting a lot of attention.
6 in the morning, police at my door. Fresh Adidas squeak across the bathroom floor. Out my back window, I make my escape. Didn't even get a chance to grab my old blue tape.
The gangster thing really starts with Ice-T, where you were put in the middle of crime. You were put in the middle of paranoia.
At the time, I was out in the street hustling. We was doing all kinds of illegal activities, pimping, robbing. My friends was like, man, write about that, man. And that was like the invention of gangster rap.
His first major hit was the song 6 in the Morning, which talked about the police raids. When Daryl Gates was chief of police in Los Angeles, they would literally start banging doors in and busting people at 6 in the morning.
Looked in the mirror, what did we see? Fucking blue lights, LAPD.
He woke the rest of the world up to the West.
All of his records were pretty much talking about things that were happening here on the West Coast. So we couldn't do nothing but respect that.
6 in the morning was, I had a gun, we beat a girl down in the street. We had, you know, we were wilding, going to jail, selling dope.
It was a wake-up call for all of East Coast people who really aren't aware of the level of gang violence that's going on in California. The fact is that the gangster thing in L.A. was, oh, it had been there going back to the 70s, all through the 70s and the 80s. Crack made it worse.
I am a nightmare walking, psychopath talking. King of my jungle, just a gangster stalking. Living life like a firecracker, quick as my fuse. Been dead as a death, back the colors I choose.
Really, the oldest gangs were the Latino gangs. With the African-American gangs, they were what was left of the ashes of the Black Power movement. And so what happened was, when you look at how the Black Panther Party completely split apart, you had a lot of kids with energy, with organization, with guns, that had nothing better to do. When Raymond Washington formed the Crips, they took over all these smaller gangs. They absorbed them. And essentially, if your gang wasn't absorbed into the Crips, those gangs ended up becoming Bloods. Something that's so small became this huge thing.
You joined the gang because, if anything, if Warren G and Nate Dogg is my friends, right? And Warren G's older brother is from this gang, and Nate Dogg is from this gang, and they my best friends, you can believe me, in the next 6 months, I'm gonna be from this gang. Because if they not gonna force it on me, I'm gonna see all of the things that they getting and they doing, and they having money, and they doing this and that, and I'm like, man, that's real appealing to me.
Once money got involved and once it became about drug territory and a bunch of other things, it was a situation that spiraled out of control.
People are afraid. They're either afraid of the government, they're afraid of the police, they're afraid of their neighbor. The crack thing created paranoia in the Black community like you wouldn't believe. I mean, a lot of LA hip hop is about fear. You know, and so I'm gonna kill you before you kill me.
Speed of life, fast. It's like walking barefoot over broken glass. It's like jumping rope on a razor blade. All lightning quick, decisions are made.
When you listen to Ice-T's gangster rap, he talks about the player side. He talks about the successful guys. What it's like when you're on top of the game.
Illegally, professional.
High Rollers was one of the first videos to depict the hustler lifestyle. And this was back in the days when MTV allowed you to show pretty much everything. I mean, we had M16s in the video, around the pool. We had guns, beepers, bulletproof vests, money. And one of the things about the video was it was all real stuff. You know, like, I mean, there were no prop guns used in it. It was funny because the crew was like, are these guns unloaded and stuff? I'm like, well, I don't know if it's that guy's flashing his particular piece. You saw this lifestyle, but at the end of the video, some jackers came in, put the shotgun to my head, pulled me out the bed, and I ended up dead on the floor. And that's my way of telling the story of that life.
You better watch your back if you want to be a high roller. Yo, the pusher, the player, the pimp, gangster, the hustler, high roller, dead press folder. It's cold lamping like a black king on the throne, evilly.
Turn up the microphone.
Ice-T opened the door to West Coast rap, a crack, okay? And then here comes the N.W.A. in the fall of 1988 and into 1989, and talk about bum rushing the show. I mean, they just smashed down a door.
Straight out of Compton is a crazy brother named Ice Cube from the gang called Niggas with Attitudes. When I'm called off, I got a sawed off. Squeeze a trigger and bodies are hauled off.
When I first heard Straight Out of Compton, yo, I really thought that Ice Cube was gonna fuck me up.
They was the first ones to actually break that chain and say, we ain't gonna make no hip hop, you know, nice records. We making records by getting our dick sucked, fuck a bitch, fuck the police. We shoot motherfuckers, whoop, 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 whoop.
N.W.A. was like the first gang on record. Straight Out of Compton, that was like going on a drive-by. And the whole attitude of the record was just, fuck you.
You could claim that Straight Out of Compton is the most influential album in the history of hip-hop. They definitely changed the kinds of things that people were talking about on records, and also changed the language that people used.
It was fuck, shit, ass, bitch. Like, it was, you know, ridiculous, and I was like, oh, shit.
We just went in there to make records, to have fun with it, and just say the wildest shit that we could say on the record and do whatever we want to do. And that was that. That's how the group came about.
What is your group now?
N.W.A.
And what does that stand for?
Niggas with Attitudes.
The name of the group is not N.W.A. It's Niggas with Attitude. Now, can you stomach that, America?
I think N.W.A. was brilliant to say we're N.W.A. It's the biggest fuck you ever. And it's not just a fuck you to white people. To fuck you to black people.
It's saying, yeah, we niggas. So you don't have no more power. So you're finished with that.
That was the first time I'd ever heard the word nigga from a standpoint of power.
When something happens in South Central Los Angeles, nothing happens. It's just another nigga dead, dead, dead.
N.W.A. of course starts in Compton. I mean, you have Eric E.Z. Wright, who was one of these kids that the capitalistic urge was always there.
E.Z. was definitely a hustler, top to bottom.
I never intended to rap in my life. I had a little money, I started a record company, and ended up rapping about stuff that I've been through. Dre was good as a producer. Ice Cube was a good writer and rapper. Randy was a strong rapper and writer. And Yella was a producer, and then myself.
And that's the way Easy does it then.
What we would do at the time is take the popular song that was out, redo it and make it dirty. I can remember us doing My Adidas, you know? We redid the beat and changed it to My Penis, you know? And Q would go out there and sing that and have the crowd laughing, you know? That's basically how N.W.A. came about. We performed in some of the raunchiest places in Compton. I've seen guys come out the audience and walk on the stage and beat the artist down that's on stage because they looked at it like, you know, you made me waste my money. You had to be good or else.
I came from Compton. That's what I wanted to talk about, Compton. You had everybody from New York rapping about my Adidas and my chain, this and this, and South Bronx and everything. I wanted to put my city on the map. I'm from Compton.
It was people that lived in Compton that were embarrassed to say they were from Compton. We just wanted to let everybody know where we were from and that we were proud to be from there.
The records we do, you know, it involves a lot of gangbanging because that's just a reality of the street out here in L.A. and Compton.
Being around N.W.A. was the first time there were a lot of guns around.
It made me slap your hands.
Guys going out on stage and getting strapped to go out on stage. We didn't have that before N.W.A.
I do look kind of bland, though.
Find the red dot.
We just took it to another level and just told it how it was, you know, without holding back.
Remember that many of the songs, one in particular, started off, what the fuck is up, who the fuck is he, coming on the mic is Easy motherfucking E. That isn't exactly the kind of songs that were being played on the radio in America at that time.
If we had went into it going, you know what, we have to make a record that's gonna get played on the radio, we would have failed. We were just making records as just something for us to listen to, something just for us to make a little money on. You know, we had no idea it was gonna blow up the way it did.
They were selling a lot of records locally. Then when Easy meets Jerry Heller, he said, because this is so controversial, and this is so dangerous, there's gonna be a market for this.
I took Straight Outta Compton to the chairman of the board of Capitol Records. He looked at me and he said, you better stop getting high on whatever you're getting high on, because this is too crazy. It was something that was very frightening to the establishment.
Fuck the police, coming straight from the underground. A young nigga got it bad, cause I'm brown.
Public Enemy opened the door to the expression of sustained anger in rap. N.W.A. blasted past Public Enemy.
The really interesting thing about N.W.A. is Straight Outta Compton was much more in the spirit of the Black Panthers than what Public Enemy was doing. Really, for N.W.A., it was about power. It was more about, this is what we're dealing with these cops and with everything else, and I don't have a message, but I'm mad, and I'm doing something about it.
No more pigs in our community.
Police are there in our community not to promote our welfare or for our security and our safety, but they're there to contain us, to brutalize us and murder us.
Instead of fuck the pigs, they said fuck the police. Those records were highly political.
But take off the gun so you can see what's up, and we'll go at it, punk, and I'ma fuck you up.
We was just letting everybody know that Black people was fed up with getting harassed by the police and getting beat-bombed.
Sometimes I want to kick the shit out of them, because they've been having me face down. Police pulled up now, and they saw my friends just having fun behind me. You know, they'd probably break it up or whatever. But you know, they assholes, man.
That was in everybody's hearts. That's what we felt, you know, being 17, 18 years old with a new car. You can't drive two blocks without getting stopped.
The reason why we made that song, we were at a mall one time, and Easy had a skirmish gun. It shoots paintballs. And I can remember driving a Samurai Suzuki Jeep, and Easy was in the passenger seat, and him leaning out the window, shooting people on bus stops. He was getting a kick out of people bugging out because it was red paint. People were actually thinking they were shot, you know? A couple of miles down the road, and about 50 police cars later, we're face down in the street, you know, with guns to our head. We left that incident and went to the studio and cut that song.
Fuck the police!
That's the way it goes in the city of Compton, boy.
Because of that record, there was a FBI memo that was written about the song and the fact that it, you know, depicted people shooting the police and everything else. Once they made the papers and once Dame the Goop got out there, record sales just skyrocketed.
I knew Straight Outta Compton was humongous when we got the letter from the FBI.
It was very frightening to me. Here's the top law enforcement official in our country telling us that we're responsible for the deaths of 89 law enforcement officers in the United States of America.
Like, whoa, okay. We touched a nerve. Now let's see what else we can do.
We make our records based on stuff that's happening where we live, you know. And people out there that don't like it, fuck them.
People don't want to give rappers the courtesy of saying that they are artists and they're a step or two away from what they create. And certainly rappers played into that because it sold records.
I done been through all the stuff, whether it was the dope dealings, the gang banging, whatever.
We already could see it was wrestling. I mean, when you stood outside of it, you could see it was wrestling.
Come with us. We're getting ready to go over here and blow up a car.
People inside of it were, you know, bought it as, you know, this is ghetto reporting. And to some degree it was, but let's be true. Unless you're the biggest drug dealer in the world, how many stories do you have? Ice Cube was going to University of Arizona when he's writing these rhymes.
Here's a little something about a brother like me. Never should have been let out the penitentiary.
With the exception of Easy, I don't think any of them had criminal records. I don't even think Easy had a criminal record. So it wasn't like these guys were actually living the lives that they were portraying on these records, but they did it so effectively on these records that it seemed real.
It's no different than the news. The news, we just telling it like it is, not holding back and using the explicit lyrics. It's like being an underground reporter.
But ultimately, every time I met Eazy-E, he was laughing. Eazy-E was laughing because he knew he was making paper and it was all funny to him.
Yo, we'll be right back with MTV, Eazy-E, N.W.A., and the whole Ruthless Posse.
Hello, but Dr. Dre, oh, yo, MTV.
When Ice Cube and N.W.A. were making their records, their main concern was South Central Los Angeles Black community. I don't think they really realized how much impact these records would have.
Yo, I'm Eazy-E.
And we're N.W.A.
Rolling down Compton Boulevard on Yo MTV Raps.
For the white suburban kid, you finally had a record that would scare your parents.
NWA was the best. You know, I loved it. I remember sitting in Florida at my grandma's house, lying out in the sun with my headphones on, just like playing a tape over and over again. I loved it.
I remember we went to Kentucky. It was the first day of our tour, and the audience was 80% white. You know, we were like, yo, are they in the right place, you know? But we went out there, girls were pulling the shirts off, had NWA wrote on their chest, and it was wild. They went crazy.
They do this huge tour. They go all over the place, millions of fans making all this money for somebody. Cube comes back and he's driving a Suzuki Sidekick. His check from all that was $32,000. And he's like, wait a minute.
The tension began when we were on a tour.
Fuck Eazy-E!
Jerry Heller comes backstage and offers them contracts. And he offers each member of the group $75,000.
We looked at these checks like, whoa, you know, nobody has seen that much money at once, you know? So they were like, but you know, you guys are not officially a group yet because we had never signed anything up to that point.
Everybody else signs. Cube says, wait a minute, I want a lawyer to look at this.
A big argument happened then, you know, we were looking at him at the time like, you know, you're turning your back on the group.
I caught Jerry Heller, Eazy-E hand in the cookie jar, and I was willing to say, you know, fuck it, I caught y'all, you know, just pay me what you owe me and we can keep on rolling. But, you know, they wanted to save face. They felt like if they paid me, they would have to pay everybody else. And, you know, so they was kind of pretty much like, fuck you, nigga, what you gonna do, go solo?
He walks away with nothing. He leaves Los Angeles, comes to New York, and actually starts recording with the Bomb Squad, the Public Enemy's production team, and makes America's Most Wanted.
Hey, yo, here's what the poster read. Ice Cube is wanted dead. That's all it said.
That was some of our primary goals when we helped produce Ice Cube's first album, is to break down the barrier between East Coast and West Coast.
Ice Cube, that's one of the most incredible men who ever touched the microphone.
When I start robbing the white folks, now I'm in the pen with the soap and the rope. I said it before and I'm still taunt it. Every motherfucker with a color is most wanted.
He managed to become even more political. The name of the album is America's Most Wanted with 3 K's. He is evolving.
Another homie got murdered on a shake.
Damn. You know, they know the gun problem in the black community, but they'll set up 5 or 10 gun shops in the black community, selling weapons that nobody's gonna ever need. I'm waiting for them to start selling tanks.
And while Ice Cube is evolving, NWA is devolving. They're going into an even more gangster direction.
Sitting in my lap as I roll up the Compton blocks, the scoop up ran, I heard shots. 1, 2, 3, then a sing ran, hopping the fence and with a 45 inside his hand.
Niggas for Life pushes everything to the edge. Musically, the record is absolutely amazing. In terms of the lyrics, they go from having a semblance of political meaning and content to going to some of the most misogynistic, violent lyrics ever committed to tape.
I pulled out my gun, now they keep me on the run. Step 6, gotta shoot you, can't forget that
I'm... That record all of a sudden is selling faster because of the controversy. It just keeps building and building and building.
Man, my appetite to kill.
Is there a positive side to gangster rap, and what is
education? Just like we did the F the Police. That's something people wanted to say for years. We said it, and it took it till Rodney King got beat for everybody to open their eyes.
When that Rodney King beating was caught on tape, I thought the same way that everybody else did. This is fucked up.
I mean, it was horrendous. It was like what happened to black people in America for hundreds of years.
We were all going like this. But only because we saw it on TV. Not because we were so shocked, like, oh my God, is a cop beating a black man? Shocking. No, it wasn't that. It was like, is a cop beating a black man on TV? This isn't NYPD Blue? Like, what the hell is going on? They got these, they got these white boys. These white boys are going to jail.
Rodney King trial had been going on,
And the word you would hear on the street in L.A. was like, yo, B, if the verdict don't come down right, it's going to be some shit. But that was just like a buzz that I had heard from a couple of people.
We, the jury, find the defendant, Lawrence M. Powell,
the defendant, not guilty Timothy of the crime E. Wynn,
not guilty of the crime of assault by force, and with a
deadly weapon. 16 people are dead, hundreds others injured in violence gripping the nation. It comes after the acquittal of four white police officers accused of beating a black motorist.
There's different groups here, but you see them moving in closer. They have big guns over there.
We definitely knew there was a lot of tension down here, and we tried to explain it to people, but nobody wanted to listen.
The records were telling you that it was crazy out there. They weren't exaggerating as much as we thought, because the explosion of anger, the unemployment, just the festering frustration that you find on all those records, it all communicates that sense of chaos and isolation that really came up in the riots in 92.
The way this LAPD was operating pre this situation, they needed to get killed, because they definitely were savage, and they were worse than any street gang in Los Angeles.
NWA is no more as far as I'm concerned, you know, unless it's on death row. That's it.
My sole reason for wanting to leave Ruthless Records was because of Jerry Heller. I didn't believe that he was being fair with anybody in the group except Easy.
I guess they took advantage of me not knowing the record business back in the day. But you know, I know what's up with those numbers now.
Dre got out of his contract with Ruthless and, you know, formed Death Row Records.
Death Row is gonna be the label of the future. Death Row is an artist label where the artist is always right. It's a situation where we give a home and have open arms to artists.
We had a studio at that time at Solar Records. I went up there and started recording my record, and Suge was taking care of the business in the meantime.
Suge Knight is a fascinating individual, to say the least. He was a former bodyguard for Bobby Brown in Los Angeles. When he was doing that, he actually began to learn a lot about the music business. The biggest concept that Suge learned was that ownership of your masters was the most important thing, because if you didn't own your masters, you didn't own yourself.
When you turn around and speak on hip-hop, you can't leave my name out of it. When you think it's turn around and speak about who own the ownership of their masters, I'd probably be the only one going like this.
Interscope Records was the only entity that would give him a deal where they would accept him owning his own masters, but at the same time putting out records, a straight-up distribution deal, which was unprecedented at the time.
Suge Knight and Dr. Dre walked in my office, and what I heard coming through speakers that I really was familiar with was something so extraordinary. I just knew that whoever did that was incredible.
Yeah, Necrotic, baby! What was it, Necrotic?
When Dr. Dre put out The Chronic, it not only changed the sound of West Coast hip-hop, it changed the sound of all hip-hop.
We all kind of grew up on George Clinton and the P-Funk era. And we used a lot of the sounds that they did. I mean, for a while, that was all I was listening to, so that was a big motivation for the first Chronic album.
A lot of our parents are from the South. So when we go down south every summer, all we hear is Parliament. I know about Parliament. I know about Funkadelic. I grew up watching my aunts and uncles getting dressed, going to the Parliament concert, so I was loving Dre. I
know you won't ride. He was able to take the best elements of the Parliament Funkadelic sound and mainstream it, but at the same time, give it that grit, that attitude, that thing that kind of made you nod your head. Really, The Chronic's an R&B record. In the most literal sense, it's a rhythm and blues record. Because he was able to kind of tap into this old soul funk gene, he was able to get listeners that might have never listened to hip-hop records.
So he begins really making pop gangster records. it's a different thing. His records are very accessible. They didn't make gangster music videos. They made music videos about girls in bikinis, big cars. There was a gangster element, but to me, that could have been the Beach Boys. It was just some black Beach Boy shit. They're having a great time. Damn, I wish I was at that party. Damn, I wish I could throw champagne on a girl's head.
First time I knew that the Chronic had a national impact was the winter of 1992. I was in East Orange, New Jersey, which is the home base of Naughty by Nature, who were at the height of their popularity. And every passing car was playing a different cut from the Chronic.
It was a big thing at that time. It was like West Coast records would not get played on the East Coast. The East Coast audience does not respect or enjoy things that we're doing out here. So for my record to break through on the East Coast, that meant the world to me.
Dr. Dre's Chronic album took hip hop and the whole concept of the album to another direction.
Yeah. This is DJ Charmaine Champagne, and this is your Chronic Direct.
It's the first time that an album in the 90s really depicted a point of view, where if you put on the record and you closed your eyes, you was with Dr. Dre and a lowrider in L.A., and you understood that whole lifestyle.
Hey, Snoop!
What up?
Hey, what's up, Dre? I heard your new album,
Mr. Bond. One, two. Bring it to the folk. Snoop Doggy Dogg and Dr. Dre is at the dope. Ready to make an entrance, so back on up.
Before I have to pull the strap off the cut.
Give me the microphone first so I can...
Star of the Chronic was Snoop.
I got my natural, I'm in effect for the nine tracks. Fuck a bald head, really though, I'm with the afro.
Snoop Doggy Dogg grew up in Long Beach. One of his best friends at the time was really into the music side. Warren Griffin, a.k.a. Warren G.
Me and Warren G was always friends from kids. We sold candy together, played football together the whole night.
Warren G's half-brother was Dr. Dre. Every time he'd see Dre, he said, yo, you really gotta listen to Snoop.
Warren G used to always try his best to get me to go to the NWA parties. And I used to be real shy. I didn't want to be around them because I felt like they were doing their own thing. But Warren G believed in it so much to where I guess it was like a bachelor party that they had. And the music had went off. And Warren G popped in the tape that we had made, and they heard the record, and he was like, I told y'all, this the homeboy Snoop. The rest is history. We started making magic.
Yeah. And that's relevant, real deal, Holyfield. And now you hookers and hoes know how I feel.
He was a little nervous, took a little coaching here and there. Even if you look back at the Nothing But A G Thing video, Snoop was crazy nervous in that. I mean, I don't think there was one take in that video where he stayed focused on the camera. But he's got that star quality, and it just showed.
I guess it's like how LeBron James feel right now, a kid playing with NBA stars and being treated as an NBA star. That's what it was for us. Dr. Dre was already Dr. Dre, and we was nobody. He didn't treat us like we was nobody. He treated us like we were stars.
I knew from the first moment he stepped on the mic, from the first word that came out of his mouth, I knew he was destined to be a superstar.
The Chronic was almost like a Snoop Doggy Dogg solo record before Doggy Style came out, and it set the stage for Doggy Style. So when Doggy Style did come out, he had a built-in audience of millions.
I wasn't a good writer, but in a battle, I could beat anybody. It wasn't nobody I couldn't beat because I was so good off the top of the head where Warren G could point at this and point at that, and I'm just tearing your ass up. Da-da-da-da, use a bitch, your mama this, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da.
Now I'm so smooth, I don't have to dish you on the camera or the TV screen. I'm funky like some collard greens.
But as far as writing, I didn't know how to write. Then once I got with Dr. Dre, he showed me how to turn my 52-bar raps into 16-bar raps.
I mean, no one had ever heard a West Coast lyricist that agile. His vocal rhythms were so different than anything else that was out.
With so much drama in the LBC, it's kind of hard being Snoop D-O-double-G.
Snoop Dogg had this way of singing that was rhyming that we hadn't heard before. He brought a whole new flavor. And he brought the Southern drawl into hip-hop. It was just a nice Southern inflection.
Laid back.
It was was insinuating, it was seductive, it was dangerous. It's a dog, it's a dog.
When The Chronic and Doggy Style become huge hits for Interscope, they now have a steady music supply coming from Death Row Records. And so what was once the label home to Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch and Gerardo is now home to the hardest of the hardcore gangster rap that's selling worldwide. And also, they had Tupac Shakur.
Watch out now. I got you. Hold on. Now. I got you. Play the beat.
Okay, let's get serious. What the rap audience ain't ready for is a real person. You know what I want to say, a real N-I-G-G-A. I'm coming at them 100% real. I ain't compromising Nathan. Anybody that talk about me got problems. You know what I'm saying? It's going to be straight up, like if I was a street person. That's how I'm coming at the whole world, and I'm being real about it, and I'm going to grow with my music.
Tupac Amaru Shakur, he was born to Afeni Shakur, a famous Black Panther. She was one of the Panther 21.
There was Afeni Shakur, who had been forced to live in the New York Women's House of Detention while she was pregnant.
She had to deal with struggles in jail, having to petition the court so that she would get better meals so that she could, you know, provide for her as of yet unborn child.
A lot of people are not from that era. They don't even know what a Black Panther is. But I'm a cat who went to school, couldn't get no breakfast, and the Black Panthers insisted that the Oakland public school system provide breakfast for the kids with the tax money. The Black Panthers insisted that police stop attacking the community. When you think about that, now think about Tupac. That's his mom. His mom comes from people who say, stand up for yourself.
My mama was a Panther. My papa was a hustler from 135th Street, you know what I'm saying? On her trial, facing about 360-something years for conspiracy to all that, she made love with my father, the hustler, and they had a baby, and she was in jail, pregnant with me. You know what I'm saying? I was came up out of that.
He was always growing up with different father figures, and so he was constantly looking at either the revolutionaries or the thugs.
I also come from the streets because I moved to California, lived in Marin, lived in Oakland, you know what I'm saying? Now I live in Los Angeles, you know, so I'm coming out the street. It's the thug life. That's all. I come out the thug life.
Once he started making records that dealt with Black Revolution or that dealt with thug life, he didn't see it as a contradiction. You know they got me trapped in this prison of seclusion. Happiness living on the streets is a delusion. Even a smooth criminal one day must get caught. Shot up or shot down with the bullet that he bought. Now
you knew when you met Tupac that he was something special. There was something about him. Even when he's doing a Humpty dance, you know this ain't, this is not it. This is not all of who he is. Watch me do the Humpty, huh?
Do the Humpty, huh? When he was in the Bay Area, he hooked up with Digital Underground. At first, was kind of a roadie. Then, you know, one of the guys on stage doing the Humpty Hump.
Snoop, who was the road manager of Digital Underground, used to go pick him up from the bus station, bring him over to me and my sister's crib so he could have something to eat. He was always broke. He was always skinny.
I was starving, 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 living in Marin. Shock was like, come on, come on the road. You could be my roadie, you know what I'm saying? It ain't gonna be glamorous, but you'll be working, you'll be meeting people. I said, cool. Got off the road, he said, well, I'm gonna pay you this, and I'm gonna let you do same song. I did same song. Ever since then, it's been on.
Tupac, go ahead and rock this.
Now I clown around when I hang around with the underground. Girls used to frown, say I'm down when I come around.
I didn't hear All Around the World same song till like the video. The people in Digital were telling me about it, and I heard it, were like, wow, amazing, but it was a verse. But when he did Brenda's Got a Baby, that's when we were floored. Now Brenda really never knew her moms, and her dad was a junkie putting breath into his arms. It's sad because I bet Brenda doesn't even know. Just because you're in the ghetto doesn't mean you can't. Like, who is Brenda? Who do we know her? Does she live in Oakland? What's going on? And he was like, it's a metaphor for all girls. Wise up. Like, why are you asking me dumb questions?
Tupac is a real artist. You know, when you got records like Brenda Had a Baby, it's on a whole other intellectual level.
I was not even aware of Tupac's depth until I started to hear him just start writing and writing and writing. And I realized he had so much to say. Since we all came from a woman, got our name from a woman, and I
came from a woman.
Pac was definitely really diverse. He had a lot of different sides, I think, as we all do. He would, at one point, have a record called, you know, Hold Your Head Up, and the next song would be I Get Around. So he would go back and forth.
I get around. What you mean you don't know?
He was struggling to find the center, and the center for Pac was to be a former revolutionary leader.
If I know that in this hotel room they have food every day, and I'm knocking on the door every day to eat, and they open the door, let me see the party, let me see like them throwing salami all over the, I mean just like throwing food around, but they're telling me there's no food in here. You know what I'm saying? Every day, I'm standing outside trying to sing my way in. You know what I'm saying? We are hungry, please let us in. We are hungry, please let us in. After about a week, that song is gonna change to we hungry, we need some food. After 2-3 weeks, it's like, you know, give me all the food, we're breaking out the door. And after a year, you just like, you know what I'm saying? I'm picking the lock, coming through the door, blasting, you know what I'm saying? It's like you hungry, you reached your level, you don't want any more. We asked 10 years ago. We was asking with the Panthers. We was asking with them, you know, with civil rights movement. We was asking. You know, now those people that were asking, they're all dead and in jail. So now what do you think we're gonna do?
Holla if you're here, man. Yeah. Here we go, turn it up, let it start. From block to block, we're snatching hearts and jacking marks.
He became progressively more gangster because he realized that even though his political records were critically acclaimed and, you know, got him a certain amount of respect and stuff, he wasn't reaching the audience he wanted to reach.
Drink a liquor and I'm looking for a bitch to fuck. All the time making money. They live poor legal as a sling another ounce. I wish it was a kilo.
That's how we rolling in the 9-3. Thug life. We stomping over all that madness that's out there because brothers is fronting. We finna take it to the streets again. If I gotta leave my record company, whatever I got to do, it's finna be in the streets again. I'm finna be saying my stuff uncensored, all that.
You get the gat too, you know what I'm saying? It's a grow too.
No, don't put that.
No, please don't.
Nah, get the gat. Let them thug life.
No, no, no.
Hit it.
I think throughout American pop culture, you've seen that people are fascinated by poverty and by crime. Hip-hop is definitely part of that tradition.
If it was just Public Enemy back in those days, hip-hop would not be where it is now. Gangster music fueled hip-hop the same way as violence fuels Hollywood.
We've never had black male celebrities like this. We've had bad, bad dudes. But these bad dudes were not projected into everyone's home on a daily basis with their shirt off, their muscles glistening, and big money in their pocket. We ain't had that in people's living rooms in Iowa.
When I started making my gangster rap or hardcore rap, they said, you can't curse on records. You can't do that if you're going crazy. I'm like, well, fuck it, that's just how I'm living. And it just was embraced by so many. I'm like, wow, there's a lot of little bad kids out here, you dig?
Just waking up in the morning, gotta thank God. I don't know, but today seems kinda odd. No barking from the dog, no small. And mama cooked the breakfast with no hog. I got my grub on, but didn't dig out. Finally got a call from a girl I wanna dig out. So hooked it up for later as I hit the dough. Thinking, will I live another 24? 24-